money. He's proven to be the most successful financial owner in the NFL, but he hasn't proven to be a great general manager per se. You dealt with Jerry Jones. Now he's dealing with the Zeke holdout, and he's saying Zeke who after a game where a backup runs well. Is this Jerry Jones being a financial genius, or is this Jerry Jones not knowing how to run a team?
Well, I think it's Jerry Jones irritating Ezekiel Elliott for one thing. And of course, Jerry says, I've earned the right to joke around this and that, but I think that's a little touchy situation when you got a player holding out and you make a comment like that can be misconstrued or whatever. And so, yeah, I think that was a little bit of a slip. I'm sure Stephen Jones, his son, who's the head of player personnel and CEO, probably wasn't thrilled about it, but what are you going to do? That's Jerry. And so, yeah, I think they've got a tough situation down there when you got all these players. The good news is they have quality players to sign, but the bad news is they've got to get them signed and then get them onto the cap. And it starts with their quarterback, Dak Prescott, who they haven't gotten a deal done with, and he's asking for over $30 million a year, already turned that down. And so that, to me, would be priority number one, get your quarterback done. And then Amari Cooper is another guy that is in the mix, although he's already making $13.9 million this year, so I think he's okay, and they could potentially franchise him next year. And so I think get Prescott done, then go to Zeke and try to get that situation done. They did sign the linebacker this week, and they're a young linebacker, and I think that was a good signing for them for the future, one of their leading tacklers.
He's a hell of a player.
Yeah, exactly. And so we'll see how it all shakes out in Dallas, but yeah, there are some storm clouds down there for the future, and they got a lot of players to sign and get under the cap. So it's not easy, but as I said, the good thing for them is they do have these quality players, and they are under contract.
Right. And, you know, Zeke, all the talk for so long in this league about running backs being overvalued or undervalued, or however you want to phrase it, basically the idea that you're going to build around a running back became passe. He's a running back you can build around.
Yeah, he definitely is. He's a big-time player. There's no doubt about that. He led the NFL in rushing last year, two-time Pro Bowler. But he's got some off-the-field baggage, and that's got to be a concern for the Cowboys, that they would like to see him stay out of trouble before they get much further along with him and give him a Todd Gurley deal or better. And the linebacker I was talking about was Jalen Smith. Yeah. That's the guy that they just signed. But I think that in terms of the contract that'll come down the pike eventually for Ezekiel Elliott, be plenty of protection for the team in terms of the guaranteed money will be tied to, and the signing bonus tied to, if he has any suspensions, there's going to be give back a signing bonus, forfeiture of some of the guaranteed money. So they're going to put the pressure on Ezekiel Elliott to mind his P's and Q's going forward. And that's a good thing.
Yeah, absolutely. So we have a couple of hot spots around the league. We have Baker Mayfield doing an interview where he rips on Daniel Jones, and we have Antonio Brown still searching for the perfect helmet. Let's start with Baker Mayfield, and I'll tell you how I feel about it, and I'll get kind of the executive view of Baker Mayfield. It doesn't bother me when players offer their opinions. You know, I'm in the free speech business. It's fine with me. I just think that Baker's opinion just didn't make much sense. You know, he ripped on Daniel Jones for not winning in college. Well, you know what? Rodney Peete and Troy Aikman played in the USC-UCLA rivalry, and Rodney Peete won a lot more games, and he beat Aikman, and that meant nothing when it came to pro evaluation. You know, Peyton Manning never beat Florida in college, and he won. You know, it doesn't mean he couldn't beat NFL teams. That's not the way you evaluate a college quarterback. So I'm not going to bash Baker Mayfield for being outspoken. I'll just say I don't think his evaluation skills are very sharp on this case.
Yeah, and Baker Mayfield forgets that he did lose in the college football playoffs, and they took the ball out of his hand. Remember that game? Mm-hmm. And didn't let him throw at the end of the game and went to overtime. I think it was against Alabama or whatever. But yeah, Baker Mayfield, I think he talks a lot for a guy who's never had a winning NFL season, for example.
Well, that's the other thing. You could rip on Baker's pro record.
Yeah, exactly. And so I thought it was out of line. I think that everybody did. And to for the most part. And I think the thing that bothers me most is that when he then backtracks on it and says, I was misquoted by the article.
He was not misquoted.
Yeah, and just to say those type of things and say it's clickbait for the media and he's bashing the media, and that's really poor form. And so it shows me his immaturity. And I think the guy's got a long ways to go. I think that Cleveland Browns team's got a long ways to go. People are anointing them as the AFC North champs. I'm not so sure they should move that quickly with them. Let's see them prove it first, including Baker Mayfield.
It's also interesting. You know, I would say that the modern athlete, in general, is pretty good at dealing with the media. They grew up watching interviews on ESPN and all across all kinds of formats. They kind of get it. They understand how to talk without really saying anything. They're very good at that. But I do remember when I covered the Vikings back in the 90s, I can't tell you how many times I would ask somebody a question, and usually in a one-on-one conversation, no cameras around, just me and my tape recorder, and they would give me the answer. And I would transcribe that answer. I would put it in the paper the next day, and they would get mad at me because I didn't write what they meant. I only wrote what they said. And in fact, I could give you, I don't want to call anybody out because, you know, it's all water long under the bridge. But there was a very prominent Viking who came up to me the next day and say, how could you quote me saying that? I said, so-and-so, you know, sir, I quoted you exactly what you said. He said, hey, yeah, but that's not what I meant. He actually told me that. So, so it is not our job to interpret what you think you were saying. We can only tell people what you actually said.
That's correct. And so, yeah, for Baker Mayfield, I'm sure there's a record of this. And yeah, he'll hopefully learn. And the Browns PR folks get in his ear and say, hey, maybe not think about criticizing other players around the league. It's probably not good form. And for especially a member of your quarterback club.
I know. Usually those guys are tight.
That's right. That's right. And as far as Antonio Brown, I thought the really interesting thing in that situation was Mike Mayock, the GM of the Raiders, first-time GM, who came out in the last several days and obviously frustrated with Antonio Brown being absent from camp and complaining about helmet and filing grievances and having his blistered feet from cryotherapy and all this nonsense that's been going on with him. And I did write about that in my sportingnews.com story that's going to come out today or tomorrow. And just from the standpoint that this is a guy that how could you not have anticipated this could happen? That this kind of stuff's going to happen. It's going to happen with Odell Beckham. It's going to happen with Antonio Brown because they're divas, because they're more interested in being celebrities at this stage of their careers than being great football players. And I think the only surprise was that it happened so early in his tenure with the Raiders before he even stepped on the field in training camp. And so Mayock says Antonio Brown has to be all in or all out. And obviously frustrated, did this press conference at training camp and ended it with no questions, that's it, end of story, and walked away. And you could see that he's angry about this situation. And I'm sure there's lots of conversations with Drew Rosenhaus, Antonio's agent, and with Antonio. Get your butt to camp, get in there, and either we're going to fine you, start fining you for conduct detrimental, or we're going to start looking at those the $30 million guaranteed in your contract and ways to possibly void those. And all of a sudden, hey, surprise, Antonio shows up and is back at work. And he says, I'm back to work. Now, no more noise, I'm just working. Yeah, we'll see.
We'll see.
Yeah, that'll last for a couple days, and then he'll be stirring things up with something else.
Oh, man. The Vikings camp, in comparison, is absolutely placid, no matter how many kickers and punters they bring in. All right, so they have preseason game, week 3. I'll be there on Saturday. Let's get your final thought on what you're going to be watching in that game. Do want to, again, thank White Bear Lake Superstore and B-52 Burgers and Brew. Jeff, final thought or your preview of game 3 in the preseason?
Yeah, hopefully we can all stay awake for another preseason game. I think this will be a lot better than game 4.
Yeah.
Game 4 is going to be brutal. And so, yeah, I think, first of all, I did want to mention that I'll be doing a post-game show on WCCO Radio, News Talk 830 WCCO, at the State Fair after the game.
Oh,
so
cool.
I'll be watching this game somewhere at the great Minnesota get together
in a beer garden.
Yeah, I got to find a TV somewhere there. Hopefully, CCO will have one in their booth, and so I'll be watching there. And I think some of the things that'll be interesting to me, as we said, it'll be the first string guys playing probably into the second quarter, and maybe a whole half. We'll see. I'm going to be looking for the offensive line to see how they're doing in run blocking, because I was not real impressed with their run blocking early on in the game against Seattle. Now, Seattle's got some stout guys up front defensively, Jaron Reed, and they were pretty tough against the run early on. All the Vikings did get some decent yardage later in the game, and Mike Boone ran pretty well, but again, against some of the backup guys. And Madison ended up with 41 yards and a 22-yard gain, but there were a lot of tough sledding in that game early. However, the offensive line has played well in pass protection, no sacks allowed in two games, and that's a positive. So, but again, teams not coming with all their exotic blitzes at this stage of the game. So I'll be watching for the offensive line, see what kind of improvement they show, especially in the run blocking, and then continue to watch the number two players as they jockey for positions on this roster, the wide receivers, the tight end position, very interesting. And we'll see how it all shakes out. We'll see if Linval Joseph perhaps gets on the field in this preseason game. He finally is back at practice after that shoulder procedure he had. And so I think that's a good thing. They've got really all hands on deck defensively now. And so preseason number three, and then, as we said, that much closer to September 8th against Atlanta.
Let's get the regular season rolling. It'll be a lot. I mean, this is fascinating. There are a lot of aspects of the camp that are fascinating, but I can't wait for the games to be fascinating. So thanks to Jeff Diamond. Thanks to everyone who listens to TalkNorth.com. Subscribe at your favorite podcast app. Thanks to our producer, Brandon Morton. We'll talk to you next week about game number three, and we'll start looking forward to the regular season opener.